We're going to be talking about the main issues around the area of securities market infrastructure. And we had some lively debate at the forum yesterday. And joining us to delve a little bit more into those issues is Jeremy Grant. He is the editor of FT Trading Room, just here on my left at the Financial Times. And Ruben Lee is also with us. He is the CEO of Oxford Finance Group. He is also the author of this book. I'll just hold that up. Running the World's Markets, the Governance of Financial Infrastructure by Ruben Lee there. So thanks to both of you for coming in this morning. Jeremy, if I could start with you first of all. I like to put all of these interviews in context, and we have people coming all parts of the financial services industry, all parts of the world. Tell us what your interpretation is of securities market infrastructure. What are we really talking about here?
Well, I think we're talking about the ecosystem in which the markets function. It's the trading, the infrastructure of trading, the infrastructure of clearing and settlement and payments, the plumbing and middle and back office. If you think about it, perhaps as a giant piece of scaffolding, perhaps that might help. And it's that infrastructure within which assets slosh around the system, to put it very crudely.
And Ruben, let's bring you in, because one of the debates yesterday, one of the hot topics, was this area of cross-border investing. And interesting, because you know it's trying to get rid of a lot of costs, it's trying to be more efficient, but it's still got its critics as well. Tell us when you think there will be no more borders for the purposes of investment.
How does never work for you? Never?
Never.
Not at all. I think we'll have currency costs, we'll have tax costs, we'll have barriers, and we'll have legal differences. So cross-border, there will continue. I will say that there has been a lot of advances in a range of jurisdictions, but if you want, when will they disappear? Never.
Okay, so not exactly a half glass full comment there from you. We also caught up, I should tell you, with Dominic Hobson. He is the editor-in-chief of Global Custodian. We asked him some questions around this issue. He talked about how the industry has raised productivity, and yes, there have been cost savings, but a lot of those cost savings have been eaten up by the regulatory process. So here's a little bit of a listen as to what he had to say.
I think one clear takeout from our session is that the industry has succeeded in raising its productivity through the better use of technology and better management methods. But unfortunately, in this environment, most of those cost saves are now being devoured by regulators forcing banks to spend the money on compliance with a tide of regulations which are washing through the industry.
Ruben, I just want to circle back with you, because you know you say you're not very optimistic about removing all of these borders. So is there no way in which this can be achieved?
Well, they're not going to disappear forever, but we have made great strides. And I think it's got to be a mixture of both public and private efforts, and we're seeing some of those. The real issue is where you have a small group of people and they want to protect their interests. Mm-hmm. They've got no interest to automate. That's one problem. And the next problem is when people spend other people's money, and that's a big problem. When they do that, then they don't have an incentive to lower costs.
Do you want to come back on some of the comments that we've heard so far?
I think it's very easy to be pessimistic about this. I think Ruben's probably right, because there are a lot of vested interests that make a lot of money out of stasis and making sure that there are these frictional costs that remain, I think. And so I think it's hard to be glass half full about it. I also think that there are in Europe, when we talk about getting rid of cross-border frictional costs and making sure infrastructures are more harmonized and streamlined, there's a big elephant in the room right now, which is the Eurozone crisis. Mm-hmm. Policymakers are obviously gripped with that. Mm-hmm. And the whole regulatory impetus to try and help streamline market infrastructures in Europe, for example, I think is going to be on not the back burner, I think that would be wrong, but it's going to be somewhat deprioritized.
I just want to come back on that note to Dominic Hobson at Global Custodian, because we asked him about what essentially the work of practitioners has done, obviously he said driving down cost, but those practitioners are not getting that recognition, and that whole plays in to these sort of vested interests that you've been talking about. Let's have a listen.
This session, it was very clear that the practitioners feel their costs have done nothing but come down for the last 20 years. There is some resentment, I think, on their part that they don't feel they're getting much credit for that, because other people further up the value chain in the shape of investment bankers and fund managers, broker-dealers, and increasingly, of course, central counterparty clearinghouses are starting to eat the savings which they are creating. So I think there is some modest ill feeling about that, yes.
Ruben, let me come back to you, because we talked about, you know, this idea of trading, clearing, settlement infrastructure. That provoked a lot of debate yesterday in the forum. How important do you think governance is to such institutions, or are we just going to be weighing people down with, as we say, more to think about and not actually focusing on growth?
I think these institutions are absolutely critical for a lot of reasons. The financial crisis has meant that people want to use them more, central counterparties. I think market participants are concerned about how efficient they are, and I think there's a general concern about corporate governance. Mm-hmm. And the reason why governance is important is that their performance, the performance of these infrastructure institutions, is to some large part determined by how they're governed. Mm-hmm. There's no right answer for everywhere, but there is a right answer for each particular instance. Mm-hmm. And that's going to require a lot of thought and a lot of politics to solve each of them.
Mm-hmm. Well, you've had this rather large book here, yeah, and I'm assuming that you've got some of the answers for that. How do you think they can be more efficient and solve some of these problems?
I think there are three aspects to that. One is, wherever you can get competition between market infrastructures, that's fantastic. Mm. So we've seen it in a lot of places in the trading sphere. Mm-hmm. Not everywhere, there are lots of jurisdictions where that's restricted, but when you can get competition, that's great. Mm-hmm. In Europe, we've seen it in clearing, and in my view, that's been fantastic. Mm-hmm. So where you can get competition, fantastic. Where you can't get competition, then you need a range of different things. Governance can help. So sometimes utility structures can mean that the institutions aren't monopolistic, transparency, and sometimes regulation as well.
Okay. And Jeremy, if I could come back to you, we've seen quite a few changes in the developed markets. Tell us what some of those changes might be and if we're going to see some of those adopted in other areas.
Well, a lot of jurisdictions are working on market securities, market infrastructures, that's true. Mm. In fact, only yesterday at the plenary session, we heard the Deputy Governor of the Bank of Canada talk about Canada's inclination to perhaps build an over-the-counter derivatives clearing infrastructure here in Canada and not necessarily be reliant on big global clearinghouses in London and New York. That's a very good example of a quote-unquote smaller jurisdiction building its own infrastructure. The same thing is happening in Japan, as we speak, even in Spain, there is a trade repository going to be launched for OTC derivatives. There's a lot going on, and I think the Asian countries in particular are looking at their infrastructure, Singapore as well. The problem with that, of course, particularly as it relates to OTC derivatives clearing, is that you end up with a balkanized structure. Mm-hmm. You have securities market infrastructure, or in this case, OTC derivatives clearing infrastructure, spread across the world, and regulators are worried about how they oversee that. Mm-hmm. That's a big issue.
And you know, we heard from Dominic that he said there isn't one big answer. There are lots of great answers in little parts of the industry. What's your view? Is there a model that everybody should be looking at, that they should be thinking, well, let's try and get more of this as opposed to less of this?
Well, to pick up on Ruben's point about governance and this question of for-profit versus utility in clearinghouses, for example, unfortunately, we're off to the races, I think, already. That you have large clearinghouses that are already for profit, and that's not going to go change anytime soon. Mm-hmm. There is, of course, a desire on the part of some market participants to have a more public utility structure. But I think it's frankly too late. Mm-hmm. We've got, the omelet's been made. You can't unscramble the omelet at this point. And I think we're just going to have to work with what we have and tweak it around the edges if possible.
Let's look forward a little bit, and I want to come back to Dominic Hobson for that, editor in chief of Global Custodian. I asked him, where is the good news, and is there in fact any? And let's take a longer term view and let's listen to what he had to say.
The good news is that if you take a 20-year view as opposed to a 2 or 3-year view, the volume of cross-border investment and trading has actually gone up very, very substantially. So capital is flowing across borders, which it wasn't doing in the 1980s to anything like the same extent. So there has been progress. I think that's the positive message, yeah.
I just want to come back to each of you. Final comments. What is the one thing you want these delegates from Cybers 2011 to take away when they go back to their offices? What is the one thing that they need to do in order to have this good news on this longer term view?
I think the key thing when it comes to securities market infrastructure is be absolutely on top of what's happening with regulation. Mm-hmm. Going back to the point that was made earlier on about that eating into people's costs, that's going to continue. You've also got Basel capital requirements coming down on the banks. There is a massive tug of war going on between buy-side, sell-side, and market infrastructure operators mm-hmm. over who's going to pay for the final market infrastructure that post-crisis regulations will dictate. And so it's watching regulation very closely and trying to get ahead of this, because it will cost you, it'll continue to cost you, and you have to keep watching it.
I think Jeremy's right, but I would pick it up slightly differently. Mm. Competition. We want as much competition as we can get, and that means that we don't want national protectionism, mm-hmm. and when regulators have the choice, mm. they need to be pro-competitive. And there are often situations where they are subject to their own political pressures. Mm-hmm. They need to withstand that and fight for it, because that's how we will all get better.
Well, we're going to see a lot about that in our next topic, which is all about exchange consolidation. And I think you hit on some of the hot topics with that extremely well. Well, thank you, both of you, for joining us. It's nice to have you with us, Jeremy and Ruben. And best of luck with your book.
Thank you
Thanks
so much.
Very much.